All right, so quantum techniques for stochastic mechanics, lesson 3 of 4. Okay, so today what we're gonna do is we're gonna review the master equation versus the rate equation. Okay, then we're gonna talk about what we called last time amoeba field theory and the equilibrium states and the stationary states of that theory. And then we're gonna do stochastic mechanics versus quantum mechanics. So this, the whole topic that we're doing today, just to motivate it again, this is a certain type of quantum technology. Okay, we're taking quantum mathematics and we're applying it to other systems, okay, which is a type of quantum technology that doesn't actually rely on quantum physical devices. It relies on a formalism, and it relies on mapping not just quantum techniques over to stochastic mechanics, but actually we sort of did the opposite. We sort of used, we took a lot of these things about stochastic chemical reaction networks, and we kind of made a Hamiltonian version of them. Okay, so today I'm going to take some stuff about Perron-Frobenius theory and Markov chains and kind of make a quantum intersection with stochastic mechanics. And there's a really, really nice end to the story that we won't talk about today that actually deals with some of the stuff that we're working on about time reversibility. And so time reversibility, the ways defined in Markov chains, is actually quite subtle and quite sophisticated. So let's just recall the master equation. I'm just going to kind of rifle through this stuff, but it should be fairly self-contained. And as we go, we can get comments from the audience, etc. Okay, so the master equation. Actually, we'll do the rate equation first. Okay, so there's k species. All right, and then xi is the concentration of the ith species. Okay, what we want to know for the rate equation is we want to know this. Okay, how does a concentration change with time? And the concentration is the average concentration, the expected value of the concentration. Okay? Now, you get one of these equations for each I less than or equal to k, okay, because there's k species, so you get a total of k of these. And the right-hand side of this is going to actually have one term for each possible reaction, for each transition in the Petri nets that we talked about before. Now, so for each transition, we end up with a term, as we recall, where you have dxi over dt, which is equal to the rate constant times ni, which is an output, minus mi, which is your input, times the product of reactants that go into the reaction. Okay, so we use index-free notation, and we define all of our vectors to be x1 to xk, etc. Then we have an input vector m, and similarly an output vector. So can everybody on that side see this okay? Because I'm sort of standing a little bit in the way, and I don't want to do that too much, but it's unavoidable. So feel free to move if anybody gets in the way. Then what we have, assuming there's one transition, we end up with dx over dt is equal to the r times n minus m x to the m. Okay, so there's t is a collection of transitions, and then if you add a sum to this, you'll end up with the full and final rate equation that takes into account all the possible transitions. M of tau, okay? And that's the end, that's the rate equation. So this gives you the average concentration of your chemical, your species, whatever it is. And the systems that can be modeled with this are governed by the principle of mass action, okay? And this is actually a wide class of physical systems. And the underlining feature that these all have in common is that things take place proportional to the product of the reactants, okay? So if it takes one person to make another person sick, then the product of two people, one being sick, one being not sick, okay, with some constant, is going to give you a term in this. All right. Now, when you talk about network science, okay, or these types of sciences where you don't have a first principles equation like Newton's law, okay, here's the situation, which is what is really going on. I actually personally think that in network science they need more philosophers of physics. Okay, we've had enough of them in quantum theory, so go over and play with that. But I'll tell you what the trouble is. So people say, oh, you can't make predictions. You don't know the rate constants. You have to find those after the fact. So you look at data from Twitter or Facebook, and these guys study phase transitions and how rumors spread and all this kind of stuff. They use these types of equations. It's true. Who's to say, what is the rate constant if somebody's sick and I'm not sick? Okay, what's the rate constant? All right, you have to basically look at data and pick that. Now, the thing is, I personally don't see any difference between that and Newton's law. It's just that we have a uniform rate constant. Okay, and we can write that down for any situation, where this really depends on the topology of your network, et cetera. So I personally think, you know, this is as good as any other science. That's my personal opinion. Some people disagree and they say, oh, it's a, you know, it's not a predictive science, all right, which is actually also a true statement. So the master equation is very different. So here we're talking about the average number of things, the concentration, or the expected value. The master equation, it keeps track of every possible outcome. Okay, everything that could possibly happen, right? In one possible universe, I don't get sick. In another possible universe, I get sick, and then I get someone else sick, et cetera, et cetera. And each one of those occurs with some probability. Okay, so what we do is we write down some vector n, say n1 to nk. Okay, these are natural numbers. All right, and then I say there's a psi, a wave function, okay, which is equal to n1 up to nk. And this just gives you some probability of this scenario with nk of these and n1 of those, et cetera, taking place. Then we cook up a formal power series. We write down z to the n, which is equal to z to the n1, z to the n, z to the k, and k. Now, that monomial, what it means is that you have n1 of type z1, et cetera, nk of type zk. We're doing this with classical particles. We're not doing this with photons or something else that you might have seen in other courses. So then we write down a state, which is going to be equal to a sum over all of these. You have a psi n now and a z n. Okay, and you take all of the n's in n of k. All right, now if I integrate this equation, it's the same as setting z equals to 1, and that equals a summation over n, psi n, which is equal to 1 for a valid state. Okay, so that's how you recover that. And for a monomial, for a single term, that's a pure state. We're 100% sure that this state, when we start out with, for instance, let's say we know how many rabbits you have, you know how many wolves you have in this population. You have n1 of those, n2 of those. So that's a pure state in stochastic mechanics. And that's different than a pure state in quantum mechanics, because you can have a superposition and have it be a so-called pure state, where in stochastic mechanics, that's not the case. Whenever you have a superposition in stochastic mechanics, it means you have some probability. Okay? So the master equation, of course, is going to provide a prescription of how things change with time, just like the rate equation. And what we end up with is we end up with this. d dt of some wave function is equal to h of t. So it looks just like what we're already familiar with. But the question is, what is h? Right? And so the first lessons were all about, how do we get h? How do we understand h? And h is built out of creation and annihilation operators. So ai psi I is equal to a derivative with respect to zi. This is an annihilation operator. Okay? And then you also can have a creation operator acting on psi, which is just multiplication by z. So for instance, That's going to add another wolf or rabbit, and this one's going to remove one. Okay, so now you could, of course, do some cute tricks where you say, what's the inner product of these two things? Okay, but this is just equal to zn a plus zn minus 1 equals a zn minus 1 equals n zn minus 1. Zn minus 1, dot, 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 equals n factorial. Okay, so you can cook up a pretty nice basis there, and you can define an inner product, and everything's fine. And the question is, well, how do we get an analog of this equation, but for this scenario, where we're keeping track of all possible histories? Okay, and the answer is, well, you have, it's almost the exact same thing. You have a rate constant, r of tau, for each transition. You have an input vector, n of tau, you have an output. You have an input vector and an output vector, okay? And you define this notation, a to the m of tau is equal a1, m1 of tau, etc., ak, mk of tau. Likewise for your creation operators, and you arrive at your Hamiltonian. And that's all there is to it. Okay? So really, given one of these, I can get one of those. Given one of those, I can get one of these in terms of equations. Actually, the expected number of things in one of these types of evolution gives back this thing. Okay? That's how those are related. And oftentimes, this one gives very good predictions, but with certain small fluctuations, et cetera, you're not going to see that. So that's why you need both pictures. And everybody can already see immediately, well, potentially, maybe not see it from this equation because it's not an example, but you can see this is very different than quantum physics. Okay, you don't need this idea of reversibility anymore. You could have an entire process where you start off with a ton of wolves and a ton of rabbits, and eventually all the rabbits die. Okay, and you really don't have that sort of scenario, at least in quantum physics. Okay, so you have it in stochastic physics. Now, we can do an example of it very quickly just to recall everybody. So amoeba field theory, right? And this is actually kind of a fun example because it talks about competition. And it talks about how a simple logistic equation, where if you have competitors, okay, that are in an environment where there's no competition, you have just virgin territory, like a virus will spread exponentially at first. Then, okay, in principle, at least in this model, after the space gets filled up, they start to compete. All right, so we talked about last time, you say, okay, you join a brand new department, okay? You see the research groups just explode. You know, they hire like 20 people in 1 year. Then suddenly, after 5 years, 10 years, they start arguing for months just to hire one new person because there's not enough space. All right, so you end up with this stabilization where there's a lot of competition. You go to an equilibrium state. But there's another thing that we don't take into account, right? So these very prestigious universities is much more competitive. There's no space, but you have a competitive advantage if you can survive in that environment. Okay, so certain things are easier, but you can't just explode exponentially. So you go to Asia, Hong Kong or China, and they're building these new quantum physics centers. And these are massive, and they're gonna fill them instantly. Okay, but eventually, when the thing's filled up, then, okay, people are gonna start arguing over, you know, they're gonna start putting 19 students in one office, okay? I don't know. So it's kind of a real life example we've all seen that just models competition. So this is an amoeba. There's fission with rate alpha. Okay, so one amoeba goes in and two comes out. That just means an amoeba splits. All right, but if you get too many of them, okay, every time you have a pair appearing twice, these things go and they kill each other, I guess, right? So amoebas somehow die if there's not enough space for them to propagate. Now, we'll make the rate of change of the amoeba with respect to time is one of them is alpha. How many things are coming out? There's two, minus one going in. The product of the reactant is A, plus the beta. Okay, now there's two things. There's one amoeba coming out. There's two amoebas going in. Okay, and there's two things going in, so I have A to the power of two. Now, okay, what type of qualitative behavior do I know about this differential equation right off the bat? What I can do is I can say, okay, is there a scenario where everything's basically, at least probabilistically, peaceful? Okay, these guys are not growing and they're not dying. Okay, so it's a very stable environment, much like an old university. Nothing's really changing. So the question would be to say that A dot is not changing, so it's equal to zero. Okay, and then in that case, let's see, what do you have here? You have A is equal to alpha over beta. Okay, now, that's right, but this is, we're assuming that you have some, you at least have one amoeba, okay, so this thing's growing. So if I started off with one amoeba, here's kind of what it looks like. There's an equilibrium state with that concentration. Everything is either going to be die-off, growth, or equilibrium, okay? And that's what's going to happen. So if you have a certain flux where suddenly a few amoebas die, they're going to grow back in that model. You have something, you know, it's a stable equilibrium. Okay, so this again is the rate equation. We're not talking amoeba master equations yet. So let's do a little bit of amoeba master equation stuff. This is actually pretty fun. So psi of t is equal to summation from n equals 0 to infinity, and you have psi n of t times zn. Okay, so you have some time dependence. We find an h. We found this one last time. It's just from the prescription. You have a plus a minus the number operator, plus a beta, a plus a, minus n times n minus 1. Okay, then that's it. Now, your amoebas over time, they just evolve exactly like we'd expect. They contain every possible history as this thing evolves in time, each with a certain amplitude. So you start off with some known, you start off potentially with some monomial. You're completely sure about what the starting scenario is, and then you see as time goes on, you have every different possible scenario. So one amoeba lives, another amoeba kills it, then et cetera, every possible different scenario. And then the question is, okay, in the master equation picture, do you have an analog of this equilibrium condition? And it turns out that you do, and there's a wide class of things called Petri nets, where Petri nets and chemical reaction networks, these all have equilibrium conditions. And so what Brendan Fong and John Baez, and I worked on this a bit too, what we did is we took these existing proofs in the chemical reaction networks literature and we cast these things over, and it's called the deficiency one and the deficiency zero theorem. And we've done most of the work on the deficiency zero theorem. And what that says is actually there's something that looks exactly like a coherent state that is the exact vector that gives the equilibrium condition of that. So your amoebas, okay, the state of your amoebas are equal to e to the cz over e to the c, okay? And that is actually the equilibrium condition of your amoeba. So it looks like a coherent state. Now, for an exercise, do this for fun. Go h psi equals 0. Show that. Okay. And also show that the expected number of amoebas in that state is c. Okay. And this is obviously a probability distribution. The probability distribution of there being n. Okay, the probability distribution of that is e to the negative c, c to the n over n factorial. That's a Poisson distribution. Okay, so it's quite cool. So in Poisson distributions, you get clumping. So for instance, you don't publish any papers for a year. You can actually use this argument with your boss. Then suddenly you're going to publish 9. Okay, that's like, it's like no buses and then a lot at once. That's Poisson distribution. Now, for fun, okay, what have we been doing so far just to kind of take a little bit of a step back and sort of motivate the next piece, which is quite well connected. So let's say I have this new scenario. The new scenario is I take a sick person plus an infected person, and I go to one infected person plus another with rate alpha, okay? And I have an infected person with rate beta, which goes to a recovered person. Okay, but you're not allowed to have more than, say, 5 people, okay? How do you do it, right? We don't do it this way, because right here you have the particle number is not conserved. Okay, to do that, you have to actually use quantum mechanics now. So in quantum mechanics, traditionally anyway, particle number, the separation between quantum mechanics and quantum field theory is the particle number is conserved. Okay? And field theory, you have these sources where particles, etc. So in this situation, I would like everybody to think about how to do this. Just model, you know, 2 people interacting. You have 2 spin 1 particles stochastically. By the end of the day, you'll totally be able to do this. Spin one particle, which is either susceptible, infected, or recovered. Okay? Then you add a transition, which if both of these are susceptible, nothing happens. Okay? Nothing's going to happen. If one or the other is infected, you have a rate where you're going to go to having 2 things infected. And if they're both recovered, again, nothing happens. So in the stochastic, you can make transitions that do preserve particle number, okay, in this formalism, for sure. And there's something... we have stochastic Petri nets. In the regular Petri net literature, they have certain Petri nets that do have conserved numbers of particles on them. But for these stochastic Petri nets we've been talking about, they don't. And after today, we'll show how to do the next part. All right, so let's make the table kind of comparing these. Okay, quantum mechanics. Stochastic mechanics. So in quantum mechanics, you have wave functions, which are maps from some set of configurations to the complex numbers. That's a wave function. In stochastic mechanics, it's a map from some configuration to the positive real numbers, okay? Such that this is a L1 operator psi. You have an integral on psi, which is actually, less than infinity. And over here you have the L2 space. Okay, now you have an inner product over here, which is a pairing. And this is how you evaluate things. Over here you just have some integral, which is just some sum in the case that we'll consider today, which maps something on L1 into R. Okay, the unitary operators, which we're all familiar with, these are just maps from L2 to L2. Okay, and last time we were actually talking about this with these Wigner functions. Okay, that would be really cool to figure out if that stuff intersects into here at all. Okay, I don't know. I actually talked to you and you sent me those papers. It's pretty cool stuff. I think it's worth checking out, actually. And okay, so over here we have reversible or unitary. Over here we have Markov processes, where if you sum over this, it's going to be equal to the sum over that. Psi, with all entries greater than or equal to zero, implies that u psi has all entries greater than or equal to zero. Now, for the fun part, okay, h equals h dagger. Okay, so when you generate this process, over here you have h is infinitesimal stochastic. So h for I not equal to j is greater than or equal to zero. Okay? And the summation over any row is equal to one. Okay? If those two conditions hold, then you have a matrix that generates a stochastic process. And so that's it. That's the table kind of comparing these two theories. And I think it's fun to look at. Now, the viewpoint that's typically taken, which is a perfectly valid viewpoint, but it's not really the viewpoint we're using in this course. The viewpoint that's typically taken is you have quantum mechanics out here, and then you have stochastic mechanics in here. So you have quantum probability theory and then this classical probability theory. In this particular viewpoint, which is our view for today, it's slightly different. It's this viewpoint. We have quantum mechanics over here, you have stochastic mechanics over here, and then you're going to have something that intersects them. Okay, so both viewpoints are valid. There's nothing wrong with the old viewpoint, but this is our viewpoint for today. So what we want to do is we want to find out what that intersection is all about. So what we're going to look for is we want to find an H such that H equals H dagger, so it's Hermitian, and it has the following condition. It has the infinitesimal stochastic condition. So if both of those conditions are true, okay, if they're both true, then you can be in that intersection. And 1H will generate both a valid stochastic process and a valid quantum process. And the matrices are called Dirichlet operators that have both of those properties. Okay, so the thesis of today's lecture, so this is basically my attempt to kind of compare these theories in the intersection in kind of a fun way. All right, so the thesis of today is you have, okay, so H is irreducible. It's a Dirichlet operator. And of course it has n eigenstates. Okay, so the thesis of today is there's one and only one valid eigenstate of this operator that is a physical state in stochastic mechanics. In quantum mechanics, you can have any of them, okay? So it's kind of this weird little reverse exclusion principle saying you're either in that unique eigenstate if you're a stochastic process, or you're in at least two, okay? Because, and we'll show everything, and it's just because this one single unique eigenstate is the only one that has the valid properties that makes it a valid state, okay? And so in quantum mechanics, obviously, any of the n eigenstates. So quantum mechanics is a theory of eigenstates, all right? And this theory doesn't quite go over to the stochastic case. So Dirichlet operator means that you're in here. So that's what it is. And okay, so a quick question is, so why are we thinking of the intersection of the generators? Why don't we think of the intersection of the maps? right? So U is both unitary and stochastic. So think about that. It's another little quiz question, is to find out when you have a unitary, which satisfies both conditions, and you'll find out that they do exist, and they're basically reversible circuits. Okay, which is quite cute, but you don't get any superpositions, you don't get anything real fun. So that's another problem. Just take a look at that. And in stochastic mechanics, so we have to have observables. So in stochastic mechanics, the observables are, these basically give a number to each configuration. So if I have an observable O in stochastic mechanics, it's actually equal to a sum over OI psi I. Okay? This right here gives rise to an observable in quantum mechanics, okay, which is basically a matrix with diagonal entries, OI down the diagonal. Okay? So that's how you equate the two observables. So basically any real valued function on psi gives an observable in stochastic mechanics. So continuing on, we really want to study this intersection because this is where the fun stuff starts to happen. And what we do is we say there's graphs to operators. So people that are familiar with network science, you'll see a lot of people saying, okay, there's a process on this dynamical network, for instance, the World Wide Web or some flu network, etc. So what they do often is they write down some network, okay, and they have potential interactions between those, whatever that might mean. Maybe a connection, there's a way to signal or something else, okay, or there's particles jumping on this, okay, there's some network. Now, we're going to consider today simple or non-directed graphs, which means there's not going to be arrows where everything's going to be bidirectional. So every time you have an arrow there, you have an arrow here with an equal weight. Okay? And the adjacency matrix of these types of graphs is quite simple to construct. Every time there's an edge, you put an entry with the strength here. Okay? And whether or not to divide by 2 is actually a debate. Okay, but it's not going to actually matter for us. So 0, 0, 0, there's no self-interaction. And you can see the rest of these are all connected, right? Okay, and then this is 1, 2, 3 connected to 1, 0, and then 2 connects to 1. You can see that, et cetera. Okay, so this is your adjacency matrix A. And you'll see already that this actually gives rise, because this is a Hermitian map, it's already valid for quantum mechanics. So I could generate a quantum mechanical system where this is, you know, this is in the site basis. You have sites 1, 2, 3, and this shows some type of transport on that system. However, it does not satisfy the second condition over here. It's not a valid Dirichlet operator. To do that, you would have to add something to this, okay, so that all of the rows sum to 1. And what you're going to do is you're going to say the H, which is valid for both, is going to be this minus L, okay, the connectivity matrix of the graph. So that's actually, that H there is actually called a graph Laplacian. But we can go outside of that. That's a pretty wide class, but we'll go outside of that today. And now H will generate both a valid stochastic process and a valid quantum process. So just conceptually, let me tell you something that's kind of fun. Let's pretend I have a particle here and I have a hopping Hamiltonian. What happens in quantum mechanics? Okay, you get oscillations, you get quantum oscillations. And there's a symmetry here between 1 and 3 if it starts here, where the probability at 1 and the probability at 3 are equal. Okay? In stochastic mechanics, what you'll actually have happen is you'll have the particle start here, then over time, it'll actually disperse and it'll become equal in all of them. And that equal state is actually your the state that is stable. It's the only one that's stable, and it's a valid physical state. So you see these people that used to study quantum mechanics a long time ago, you hear the word quantum beats. Okay, so what they're talking about is these oscillations that take place in quantum mechanics that don't in stochastic mechanics. And what's actually quite funny is like what Zoltan will say, but these Hamiltonians are time symmetric. And he can go and he can break this, we can break this time symmetry, and you can actually do different things with this. So connected graphs, we're interested in transport on these graphs, effectively. So we only consider graphs that are connected. And in quantum mechanics, we always can think about observables which are positive semi-definite. All right? Now, in stochastic mechanics, we can consider kind of a weaker condition. We can consider matrices that are positive in a more basic way, okay? So there's an n by n real matrix T, okay? And it's positive all of its entries are greater than zero. Okay, so this is, you know, there's some matrices out there that are like that. Okay, actually a Markov matrix is like that. A Markov matrix has that property. Okay, maybe. It doesn't have to, because some of its entries could be zero. Okay. And vectors similarly, okay, psi is positive if for all I, psi I is greater than zero. Okay, now non-negative is a different condition. Non-negative means I can switch these like this. That's the difference between positive and non-negative. So with all of this Perron Frobenius stuff, you have to read it very carefully if it's positive or non-negative, because otherwise it sort of changes it. Now, stochastic states are obviously non-negative. Quantum states are not necessarily the case, but many quantum states that we're familiar with, such as GHZ states, okay, those have coefficients that are actually non-negative. The complete superposition state would have the complete superposition over all possible states would actually be positive, because every single entry of the vector would have a positive entry. Okay, so now we'll talk about Perron's theorem. Okay, positive T. Okay, there exists a positive number R, okay, where R is an eigenvalue of T such that any other eigenvalue, R is greater than equal to all of the other eigenvalues of T. Okay, so it's the largest one. And it's positive. Okay? Furthermore, there exists a psi in R, and psi is positive. Okay? And you have this condition, T psi is equal to R psi. Any other psi that satisfies that, okay, is a scalar multiple of that psi, so you have some uniqueness. Okay? And you can go further. This is an important part. This psi is the only eigenvector that has that condition. It's the only one that's non-negative. That's a very strong condition. That means that every other eigenvector of that matrix is potentially either has a negative entry, okay, because there's not complex entries in these all the time, but there could be in what follows. And you can always pick psi to be positive under these conditions. And Perron's theorem does not hold for non-negative matrices, right? It only holds for positive matrices. Okay, so for instance, it wouldn't hold for this matrix, etc. It wouldn't hold for the identity matrix, okay, because there's zero entries. Okay, so Frobenius, he took and he generalized this result actually as far as it could go under these under some simple assumptions. Okay, so the new theorem, which is the Perron-Frobenius theorem, doesn't apply to all non-negative operators, but to irreducible ones. Okay, so if the thing is irreducible, you get a theorem which is very, very close to this with one small little tweak. Okay, so what is an irreducible operator? An irreducible operator means you have some graph, okay, where if I want to get here, there's some path to get there. Okay? But if I want to get back to here, I need to be able to get back to there. Okay, so I need to be able to get anywhere. There's some directed set of edges that allow me to go everywhere. If your graph doesn't have direction, then these are all going to be irreducible and actually strongly connected. Okay, so if the underlining graph of an operator is strongly connected, then you can apply the Perron-Frobenius theorem. Okay, so now, the Perron-Frobenius theorem. Okay, so we'll add a little bit more here. All right, so everything is the same. There's only one condition that is different. Okay? The only condition is that R is greater than or equal to any other lambda. Okay? So now what you do is you have the spectral circle. And all it says is the R is on one side of it, and it's on the outside of that circle. Okay? In every other way, this is stronger than Perron's original theorem, because Perron's theorem says it's actually greater. Okay? But this actually tells us a lot about a certain class of operators. And likewise, we still have all the other same properties, like psi is still the only unique state. And you can kind of see what I'm sketching here. I'm sketching this thing where we're saying, okay, inside this intersection, we're going to apply this theorem. Okay, but it doesn't apply directly, so we have to do a little bit of switching around. And inside that theorem, we'll get we'll be able to apply this theorem and then show that there you, in, when this intersection happens, you only have one eigenstate, okay, for the stochastic cases that are going to be valid physical states. And actually, it turns out that you can prove that it's the unique equilibrium state of these stochastic processes, and we'll go through and do it. So there could be other lambda that are going to equal R. A perfect example, which we're all familiar with, what happens here? R is equal to 1, but you also have negative 1. Okay, so you have a spectral radius, right? Your R is here, but you also have something else here. That's your other lambda. Okay, so you have to be careful when you apply that. So now we'll look at an irreducible Dirichlet operators. Okay, so from any finite simple graph, we can actually get one of these. And the edges are all labeled by positive real numbers, etc. So H is a trouble, though. Okay, this I can't apply Perron-Frobenius theorem to, okay, because it has negative entries, right? So what do? Well, the way we fix it, okay, is we're going to say we have a new operator T, which is equal to H plus some large constant times identity. Okay, do you see that? Now every single entry is at least zero. It's going to be greater than zero. And you can always do that. That actually just shifts the spectrum. Okay? And of course, T has the same eigenvalues of H. And the underlining graph of T is still A. It's still strongly connected. So we haven't changed anything in the problem. All we've done is we've shifted it so we can apply that theorem. So the Perron-Frobenius theorem applies. Now the lemma is that H is a Dirichlet operator from a finite simple graph with positive edges, and then all of the eigenvalues of this new operator are real, okay? Lambda is the largest eigenvalue, and it actually turns out to be zero in this case. And there's a positive vector psi, okay, which is this, H psi equals lambda psi. And this is the only non-negative vector. And hence, you basically can look through the blog post that I passed out. I actually have a few more copies for anyone that wants it. And it sets up the whole situation. And the conclusion is that this will actually turn out to be the only valid eigenstate. And you can see that that actually has eigenvalue 0, which, and all the other ones are less than that when you do these shifts to make it into a valid stochastic generator, which means that you end up with, if you end up in a superposition, everything else decays and it all goes to that state. Okay, so that's a unique stationary state. And it's stable. Okay, so now, just to go through and just to kind of see this in action, we'll conclude with an example and finish right on time. Okay, so picking an example just to see this in action. Okay, there's your example. From that, you write down your adjacency matrix. Okay, so you can see already that A is equal to a dagger. So it's a valid quantum mechanical generator, but it's not a stochastic one. So what we do is we write down our Hamiltonian is equal to A minus 4 times the identity. Okay, so that fixes the problem. And we constructed this example. It actually has a very simple ground state, okay, or equilibrium state. Okay, so the equilibrium state in this case is actually psi equals 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so what happens is if you start traveling around on that network with those coupling constants, you eventually spread out and nothing happens anymore, which is not the case at all for quantum physics. Okay, so now the other eigenvalues, as we've proven, so you check these in Mathematica, you have 0, negative 7, negative 8, negative 8, negative 3. Okay, so this is the largest one because we're energy shifting now. So the Perron-Frobenius theorem still applies, but you have a shifted spectrum. Okay, all the other eigenvectors, for instance, v1 is equal to 1, comma, negative 1, comma, negative 1, 1, 0. All of them they're not non-negative. Okay, they have negative entries. All right, so in order for me to have a valid physical stochastic state, I could do something like this. I have to say psi A is equal to 1 minus A, V0 plus plus A V1. Okay, A is equal, A is at most 1/2, and it's greater than 0, or equal to 0. Okay, so then you can have these, and you have to add them. So it's kind of a reverse exclusion principle, putting it back into our language. And this works for any irreducible Dirichlet operator. So anything in that intersection, this is always going to be good for. And that's, I think that's kind of a cool, it's kind of a cool way to compare them. And actually, if somebody else has a different way to compare this stuff, I'm sure there's many other ways to kind of look at comparisons that are interesting and potentially even more interesting than this comparison. Next time we'll talk about disease spreading on a lattice. Okay, just to kind of finish it off that way. And we'll bring in a little bit more of this stuff, and I might talk about conserved quantities. And on the lattice I have in mind, it's actually a chain, and the deficiency 1 theorem applies. So you end up with multiple equilibrium states. Okay, so that's it for today, unless there's, as always, there's an open discussion afterwards, so we can kind of chat about it and just sort of, you know, see what people's ideas are.